Hey everybody, this is Alex Merced, and welcome to another episode of Web and Data Interviews. And I'm really excited because I have a friend who I was on her podcast not too long ago, and it was a great conversation. So she's going to be telling you about all sorts of really cool stuff. And that is Monica Royale, who's going to be telling us about her career in the data space. So welcome to the show, Monica.
Thank you for having me on the show, Alex.
Yeah, super excited. Now, generally, I always like to start off the show with having people kind of tell us their origin story, sort of where thou cometh from or whatever. So, Monica, tell us your origin story.
Awesome. Yeah, so me, like many others in the data field, I feel like I did it by accident. Right? A lot of origin stories kind of accidentally stumble into their superpowers, and I feel like I am the same. So I started out my career as an IT security auditor, and I got my degree in accounting and MIS, and those two kind of merge into IT security auditing. And as I was auditing, I didn't know anything about data. And we kind of went about our testing in a very manual process. That's just how we did things, right? We were basically testing to make sure that systems in companies were configured appropriately to standards and regulations. And about, I think, 3-ish years into my career, that's when I learned about data. And from then I was kind of hooked. I was like, what is data? What is data analytics? How can I use it in my job to make my job and my life a lot easier? So I took a lot of courses and did some projects and basically started using data where I was. And that's how I got into data.
Got it. And then what were some of your favorite like topics in those courses or projects that you did in those sort of early stages of like building up these skills?
A lot of what I was doing fell into descriptive analytics, kind of figuring out trends that were happening. And a big one was anomaly detection. So just finding out different outliers or just odd things that would happen in different population sets.
Awesome. And what are your go-to tools? Because there's so many tools in the data space and the number of tools are constantly growing. Like every day I hear about some new tool or some new version of a tool. So what are sort of your go-tos when you feel like you have to like, you know, crunch some numbers and generate some charts? What are your go-tos?
So back then, it was all in Excel. I started out my journey in Excel. My first programming language that I learned was R. And I applied the combination of R and Excel for a while in my career until I transitioned to a company that used SQL a bunch. So SQL and Tableau was what they were using. And then at that time, R kind of faded out and everyone was kind of hopping on the train of Python. So I got on that train and have been using Python a lot recently.
The Python train. It's a good train. It's got a great meal car. on that note, I mean, you also have been, you know, helping people also kind of break into the data space with career coaching. Tell us sort of how you get into that and how does that usually work?
Definitely. I think it came from my own origin story and just understanding that like data is everywhere and everyone can really be a data professional. And you know, I did it myself. I started using data at my current job. So that's kind of my advice for everyone if they want to transition into the data space, kind of start out with trying to use data where you are.
Awesome. And basically, if someone was like interested in sort of getting like coach, like where would they go? How would they go about that? How does that process start?
Yeah, so follow me on LinkedIn if you are trying to transition your career into data. But there are many, many coaches available out there. My coaching program specifically tailors programs for people leveraging their current skills and kind of finding a path to get to your specific goals. Because I don't really think that there's one kind of journey or path to get you to where you are going. So I don't have one of those kind of PDFs that say, do XYZ in this sort of priority, right? Because everyone has a different story, has a different background, has different skills and all of that. And so my stuff is very based on personal experience and tailored.
Got it. Okay. And then on that, I mean, you know, for all those like lifelong learners, not only do you provide like the coaching, but you've also done some LinkedIn courses. So one, tell us what content you're covering in those courses, and two, sort of like what is the experience of building a LinkedIn course? Because like, I might be doing that in the near term, but I'm not sure what to expect.
Yeah. So my LinkedIn Learning course just recently launched about a month ago now. It was such a wonderful experience. It's on a topic that I nerd out on, data security, right? Because my background is in that security, risk, and compliance area, and I just really enjoy that security space. And so I was like, oh, that would be really cool if I could build a course out of it. So I started giving presentations at different like local meetups that I'm part of here in Phoenix. And then I was like, oh, maybe I can like actually build this into a course. So I got in contact with one of the LinkedIn Learning folks. And then from there, I just was able to build out a course and go to California to record it. Everyone there was so wonderful. It was such a wonderful experience. And I do recommend it to anybody that's interested.
Awesome. Awesome. And speaking of you're in Phoenix. So that means you've probably crossed paths with a new colleague of mine by the name of Andrew Madsen at some point.
Yes, Annalise.
Yes. Okay, yes. Oh, yeah, that's just right. They're both in Phoenix.
Yeah.
Oh, so many of my Dremio compatriots over there in Phoenix. I need to go. I haven't been there. I went to Phoenix once, but that was way before I was even in the space. So one of these days, I need to go make a visit with so many people
you
there.
You should. Not in the summer, though. I advise not to come here.
Oh, I just used to it. Figured I'd just do it in the hottest day of the summer, yeah. You know, when it's the coziest.
August, then. If that's what you're trying to do, come in August.
Yes. You know, saunas are healthy. but on that, like, you also are the host of a podcast. Tell us a little bit about that show. Like, I'm familiar with it, but for all those listening, tell us about it.
Yeah, so I have a podcast, Data Podcast for Nerds. And what we do is just talk about all of the different skills that data professionals actually use on a daily basis. And then we always incorporate nerdy fun bits. And it's really just incorporating people's hobbies and how the skills that they use for their hobbies are actually quite similar to the skills that they use in their daily lives at their jobs. And again, just highlighting that everybody can be a data analyst, data professional if they want to, because data is just everywhere.
It is everywhere. Once you kind of get into that mindset, it's like you can't look at anything without like putting it into a table or a JSON or whatever. And on that, let's kind of get into that. Let's just get into sort of like hobbies and stuff like that, because one, you have a really cool background. So like when I take a look at like back there, you have a lot of cool stuff over there hanging out in the corner. So I'm sure some of that reflects some of your interests, hobbies. So let's go a little bit into there. So tell us a little bit about sort of like the things, at least in recent times, like shows you've been enjoying, music you've been enjoying, TV you've been enjoying, what's sort of been the binge-worthy stuff in Monica's world?
Oh my goodness. I kind of bounce around everywhere and just watch anything that I can get my hands on. I really am into Korean dramas lately. Mm-hmm. They're just so eye-catching and interesting. My favorite genre, I think, would be psychological thrillers. Ones that just like really twist your brain while you're watching it. And the ones that don't follow a specific timeline, the best. Like Memento.
Yeah, exactly what I was thinking of.
It just like bounces all around where you're like, have to actually pay attention to understand the story, and then there's twists and turns and all that jazz. Those are my favorite.
Yeah, no, I love those. Like Memento, of course, stands out. Pretty much most of Christopher Nolan's library just stands out. But then also like Identity, a few others I can think of. But yeah, oh, how about like now Korean dramas? Like I haven't watched Korean dramas before, but I have watched Spanish soap operas because I grew up watching those with my grandma. Are they similar? Are they more in that vein, or are they more like American soap operas where it's like going on forever and kind of thing?
So the ones that I actually find myself watching are the ones that are kind of more like puzzle games, real reality show type, but they're like all working towards a specific goal. Kind of like game show vibes a bit. I forget what the one that I just watched, something like Eight Floors or something like that, where there is one building, there's eight floors, and each person is in one of those floors, and they basically just have to survive each day to earn money. And of
Got it.
course, there's like all things that happen, everyone turns on each other, and just like all kinds of craziness. But it's interesting because there's like an analysis and strategy that goes on, right? And
Got
that's
it.
what keeps my
Did you watch,
attention.
I mean, everyone watched Squid Games, but did you watch like the Squid
Well,
Games game show that came out with afterwards?
I did. It was a bit strange, but still
Yeah, that
enjoyable.
was like I had to say they definitely captured the psychological drama of the show, or like the psychological torture of the show. I was like, I can't believe they did that. Like, oh, the whole like, I mean, no spoilers, so you have to watch it, but there's definitely a few scenes where like people had bond pre-existing bonds or formed bonds that had to end in the most tragic ways.
Oh, goodness gracious, yes.
Yes. Oh gosh, that was it was good. Like I was like, he's like, no one had to die for this, but some people are probably have PTSD after this.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no. What else is fun? Any movies you've seen recently?
I'm really dying to watch Inside Out 2,
Oh,
but I
so
have
good.
not yet seen it. The last movie that I did watch was Dune 2, though.
I have not seen Dune 2 yet. That's also on my short
Oh,
list. Okay,
yeah,
I gotta get
good
on
one.
that. Get that and okay. What else? Yeah, I don't know. I'm actually drawing a blank. It was as super. I've been just watching like basically the last week. I've just been binge watching like The Boys and Gen V and all the boys stuff,
Yes,
whatnot.
I, yep,
So
yep.
good, so good. So much good stuff today. We definitely live in an abundance, and a lot of that abundance is thanks to data. So people can more efficiently allocate funds to make us all this cool stuff to watch.
Yes.
On that, like let's kind of circle back to like you like Excel and R. I think at most I've probably maybe written a line in R once upon a time, a long, long time ago. I never used R with Excel. Like, how was that experience of like using R in Excel? Is that something you can use like directly in Excel, or would you do like prepare data and then load it up into Excel?
Yeah, so now I think that you can mix the two. I'm not quite sure, but when I was doing it, I would obtain data from stakeholders in an Excel format, and then I would just import it using R like you would
Okay.
read CSV in a Python with pandas, right? You would
Got
do that in R, and then from there I would do the analysis just using the R and visualizations using R as well.
Got it. Understood. Understood.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Makes sense. Okay, cool. Now if someone out there is thinking, okay, what are some of the best bits for me to start kind of like getting my feet wet? What are sort of like the low-hanging fruit of like things to sort of like start practicing and playing with data? What would you recommend?
I do believe that Excel is a good starter place because almost every company has Excel. And it's so easily available to them. And it's already used. If it's already used in your company, then I would say to start there. That's just in general, something that your company already has, start there. And then if you want to get into like visualizations, Tableau has a really good public platform. And also a community. There's Makeover Mondays and Workout Wednesdays, and they kind of give you different data sets and prompts as to what problems that you want to solve. And then you go on to your Tableau public and build out what you can, and then share that out on different social platforms.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people take for granted just with that how much you can do. Because I mean, everyone always talks about like the big data, like oh yeah, like what can handle petabytes of data, but like most companies aren't dealing with even 10 terabytes of data. So like Excel can handle a good chunk of what most companies are doing most of the time. Like just with that pair, like that's probably most enterprises. So yeah, no, I think that's fabulous advice. With that, we'll start kind of wrapping up. So I don't know if there was any places you wanted to point people to, as far as like where they can learn more about you or things you'd like to kind of call attention to. I will sort of give you sort of a blank slate to point the audience wherever you like.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I am very active on LinkedIn, so please follow me there. I do have a LinkedIn learning course, Protecting Data for Analysis and Machine Learning. And I also am on YouTube. That is where my data podcast for nerds is, as well as all of the fun streaming platforms. And I think that's about it.
Awesome. Well, no, that's plenty. So basically, yeah, go follow Monica, subscribe to her podcast, go check out her course. And yeah, no, I mean, it's always really, really great stuff. Always enjoy seeing it in my LinkedIn feed. And again, thank you, Monica, for being on the show today. As always, it's been a wonderful conversation.
Thank you very much, Alex.